come to you to receive the fruit of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ may be seen.
Welcome to Twickenham. Glad to have you here this morning. Thanks for coming out to be with us. I have already had the privilege of meeting a number of folks that are visiting with us today. Thank you guys for coming. If there is anything we can do for you, I hope you'll let us know. If you are looking for a church home, we would love to talk with you about what God's doing here, hear about what God's doing in your life, and see how our stories match up. Just glad you're here. There is a card on the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and you can place that in the collection plate when it passes a little bit later in this service. And welcome back to the Smiths. Glad you guys are here. Brad did a great job leading for us last week. Lincoln and Amy were actually in Iceland. They were exploring what it would take for us to get a curling team here at Twickenham. So, awesome. One of our traditions here is that we, when there's a new baby in our midst, we want to pray for them. So Charles and Michelle Thompson are here this morning with Abigail Elise, and Bill Bass is one of our elders. He's going to lead us in a prayer as we pray for her. Is she asleep? Finally? Okay. So golf clap, okay? Just golf clap, and we're going to pray for Abigail Elise here.
You bow with me, please. God, what a blessing it is to have new life in a congregation. God, you have blessed us greatly, and now we're so thankful for Abigail. We're thankful for this family and for the blessing that you have provided for them. God, we come to you now to say thank you, and to covenant with this family as a Christian family here to provide an environment where Abigail can grow and can learn about you and can turn into the Christian woman that we all want her to be. God, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for caring for us. And we thank you for your son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hey, let's all stand together as we worship the Lord together. In unity.
One heart, one spirit, one voice. to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ.
Calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope. When you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and the Father of all, who is over all and in, through all and in all.
Be seated as we take our offering.
Bind us together, Lord. Bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together.
Supper, I'm going to read from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit, and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Have any of you ever been offended before? I know all of us have, and usually it's when we don't feel like we've been given the proper respect that we deserve. And really, there's nothing more offensive that I can think of than the fact that Jesus, the King of Heaven, left that heavenly place and came and took human form. Because really, that's a complete mismatch to the honor and the glory that he is due. And not only did he take human form, but he allowed himself to be treated like the lowest of the low humans, allowing himself to be, even receive the worst offense that anyone could possibly receive, which is to be killed. And of course, why did he do that? It's because he came to save us, because he valued our lives as greater than his life. And so in having Jesus as that example, as Paul exhorted the Philippians in that passage that I just read, in our relationships then, we can strive to put others, to have that mentality of Jesus, that mindset, to put others as higher than ourselves. You know, God never said that there won't be offenses. As a matter of fact, the Bible pretty much says the opposite. But maybe when I don't feel like I've been given the respect I deserve, or maybe when I feel like I've been slighted. Maybe I can just defer to other people. Because if Jesus considered them as more important than himself, then who am I to elevate myself higher? So now as we're about to eat the bread and drink the juice that reminds us of that body and that blood that was poured out for us, that body that he humbly laid down for us, let's pray. Holy God in heaven, we just give you thanks for Jesus Christ, who is our salvation. And we thank you not just for that salvation, but we thank you for your wisdom in giving us this time of remembrance that we have every week to remember what he did for us, to remember his example of humility and love. And I pray that we will take that example and this remembrance not just now, but with us this week, every day, in our thoughts, our actions, and our relationships with others. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
As we prepare to take this juice, we thank you so much for the blood of Jesus. We thank you for the salvation. As we've been reading through the Old Testament, we're reminded of the violence of the Old Testament temple worship And we recognize that Jesus himself went through that same violence for us, God, because of his love for us. Let us not forget the tremendous love that he showed for us, God, and the place that he put himself in, all for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Holy Spirit,
we believe in the Holy Spirit,
the
are the church and we stand as one.
We are the church and we stand as one.
We believe in the Holy Bible.
Cooper had our scripture reading this morning. Wyatt, great job, man. Really good job. You guys give this young man a hand. He did a great job. So. Matt, you did good too. Hey, so last week we started a series in the book of Joshua, Faith for Where We've Never Been. And if you want to go ahead and turn to Joshua chapter 1, that's where we'll be again this week, this morning. In the last week, we talked about the inertia in which our lives can become stuck, the sense that nothing is ever going to change, that we just as well get used to how things are because that's how things will always be. We'll struggle with the same temptations, the same relational dysfunctions. We'll keep making the same mistakes. We'll keep living with the same consequences. Same, same, same. And we confess that every time we use phrases like, that's just who I am, as if who I am is basically not that much different from a stone statue that never changes expression or location or position. I heard a preacher one time said, there's only one I am, and the rest of us are changing. But that's what we say sometimes. Somebody says, you need to change, I know I should, I actually want to, but then I bail on my responsibility, and I just say, well, that's just who I am. And then we'll use the phrase, that's just how it is, as if the possibility of a different way of living is as remote as Auburn and Alabama merging to form a single university located in Mobile. And then there's the big one, the mother of all concessions to inertia. The confession that we've given up on a different future altogether. We say, it is what it is. So what we learned from the first 9 verses of Joshua last week is that with God, how things are is not how things will always be. The future is not. It is what it is. Israel had been locked into slavery for 400 years when God liberated them from that oppressive inertia. And as the book of Joshua begins, God is bringing them out of 40 years of living a nomadic lifestyle in the wilderness to a new life as a nation settled in its own territory. And all of that is a part of God's unfolding plan, a narrative that God is writing through history. And he's going to use Israel, just as he promised Abraham, he's going to use Israel to bless all nations. And you and I are a part of the all nations blessing that came from Israel. Now, that transition from that nomadic lifestyle to a settled lifestyle is huge. It's the difference between living out of a suitcase or standing in your massive walk-in closet trying to decide what you're going to wear. It's the difference between using your car or truck as an office or driving to your office in your car or truck. For 40 years, Israel had basically been living with the disorientation of waking up in a strange hotel bed every night, every few nights. And now they're going to know what it's like to wake up in the same bed, in the same house, in the same city every day. Their inertia made them road weary, and now they're going to experience rest. That word rest is an important word in the passage that we're about to hear together, and so is how that rest is achieved and what we do with it when we get it. So I just want you to listen with me to Joshua chapter 1. We're going to begin in verse 10, and we'll read down to verse 18. I'm reading from the English Standard Version this morning. Here we go. And Joshua commanded the officers of the people, "Pass through the midst of the camp and command the people, prepare your provisions, for within 3 days you are to pass over this Jordan and go in to take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving you to possess." And to the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, and we're going to come back and explain that part, Joshua said, "Remember the word that Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, 'The Lord your God is providing you a place of rest and will give you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your livestock shall remain in the land that Moses gave you beyond the Jordan, but all the men of valor among you shall pass over armed before your brothers and shall help them until the Lord gives rest to your brothers as he has to you, and they also take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving them. Then you shall return to the land of your possession and shall possess it, the land that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you beyond the Jordan toward the sunrise.' And they answered Joshua, 'All that you have commanded us to do, we will do. And wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we obeyed Moses in all things,'" which, to be perfectly honest, is a little bit of a stretch, "'so we will obey you. Only may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Whoever rebels against your commandment and disobeys your words, whatever you command him shall be put to death. Only be strong and courageous.'" Okay, so if you're unfamiliar with how ancient Israel was organized, there were 12 tribes that made up the nation, and the tribes were divided into clans or families. The tribes were named for the sons of Jacob, who was also known as Israel, which is why sometimes they're referred to as the children of Israel. The tribe of Joseph was actually made up of 2 half-tribes, and they were named for his sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. So in the verses that we just read, you've got this strange conversation between Joshua, who has succeeded Moses and now is the leader of Israel, and the two of the big tribes, Reuben and Gad, and the small half-tribe of Manasseh. So what's going on with all of that? Well, Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh were like the Texans of ancient Israel. They were ranchers, big into cattle and sheep. And when they arrived on the outskirts of the Promised Land, they noticed that the territory east of the Dead Sea and the Jordan River was ideal for grazing their herds and flocks. And they were really tired of being free grazers, so they wanted to settle down, and this land was perfect. The problem was that the promised land was west of the Dead Sea and the Jordan River. And so they asked Moses, who was the leader at the time, if they could just settle on the eastern side instead of crossing over the Jordan with the rest of Israel. If you've joined us in our reading plan this year, the Read Scripture plan, then you would have read about that this week in Numbers chapter 32. And if you haven't joined us, come on. You can do this. Just pick up where we are and go to our website. You can download the app, and there's a lot of great resources there for you. You can get into this. You can do this. Just join us wherever we are. All right? So anyway, you would have read about this in Genesis, in Numbers 32. Here's what happened. When Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh made this proposal to Moses, he went ballistic. Basically, he said, this is exactly what your ancestors did 40 years ago when we were here the last time. They chickened out on crossing the Jordan and taking the land. And so, to punish them, God made us wander around in this desert for the next four decades. So, two things are about to happen. A, you're going to make God mad. And number two, you're going to discourage the rest of the tribes when they hear that 20% of the fighting force is going to sit this one out. Thanks a lot, guys. So much for unity. The leaders of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh were like, no, Moses, you don't understand. We're not afraid to fight. In fact, if you'll let us settle in this land, we'll put on our armor and we'll be the tip of the spear. We'll go in ahead of everybody else. We will fight for our brothers and sisters so that they can have their land if you'll just let us have this land. It's not about fear of fighting. It's just, this is really good land. And when Moses heard that, he said, okay. So now Joshua is reminding the leaders of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh about the promise they made, and he's holding them to it. And there's a good reason for that. Because when you look back through the story so far, what you find is that God's people do not have a very good track record for the important virtues of loyalty and unity and being there for each other. In fact, we stink at it. All the way back to the garden, when God confronts Adam and Eve, the first thing Adam does is throw Eve under the bus. He blames her for his sin. And then in an apparent fit of jealousy, their son, Cain, kills his brother Abel and leaves him bleeding in the field. So much for unity. And then Jacob, the father of the 12 tribes, tricks his own father, Isaac, and steals the blessing that should have gone to his brother Esau. So much for unity. And then Jacob had his 12 sons, but he loved Joseph the best. His other sons are so tired of their father's favoritism toward their brother Joseph that they sell him into slavery. He was a bit of a diva, but that's no way to treat your brother. There's no unity, no loyalty going on anywhere in the past. So you can't blame Joshua for revisiting the deal the 2.5 tribes made with Moses. But here's the question I had when I went back through this story. Do the other 9.5 tribes really need their help to begin with? I mean, back in Genesis chapter 14, God empowered Abraham to defeat the enemies, to defeat the armies of four kings with only 318 soldiers. 318 against four armies, and Abraham won. In the future, God will defeat bigger foes with fewer numbers. So you can't really say it's about the numbers, because to God, numbers don't matter. God can do more with a few faithful people than millions can do without God. So why is this odd little story even in here? Maybe something way more important than a head count is at stake. Look again at verses 14 and 15. I think there's a clue there. Joshua says to Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, your wives, your little ones, your livestock shall remain in the land that Moses gave you beyond the Jordan, but all the men of valor among you shall pass over ahead of before your brothers and shall help them until the Lord gives rest to your brothers as he has to you. You guys have to go help your brothers and sisters just as God has helped you. God has given you rest. Now you must help your brothers and sisters find rest too. In other words, because of what God has done for you, you must be there for others. All of our songs this morning have focused on the theme of unity. We are the body of Christ, bind us together, a common love, blessed be the tie that binds. Unity is such an important theme, scripturally. I mean, the first sermon I preached here was based on Ephesians 4. And I told you that one of the things that we needed from each other was a commitment to unity. But when you and I hear the word unity and think about the concept of unity, I think we sometimes fail to understand what it's really calling us to. For example, we think that really all unity is talking about is that we agree on matters of faith. Well, I would say it certainly includes that. It's kind of hard to be united with somebody who does not believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be. But unity is so much bigger than just agreeing on a set of propositions. That's what's at stake. When Joshua reminds the three tribes of their previous commitment, being a part of that united nation meant that they needed to provide practical help to their brothers and sisters. The story in Joshua 1 answers two simple but very profound questions. The first is this: why are we here? Why are we here? And the answer it offers is this: we are here to help. We are here to help our brothers and sisters. As I was working on this past week, I thought about you, and I thought about the ways that you do this so well. Sometimes you do it in really formal kinds of ways, through organized ministry efforts. Some of our church family are currently helping others in a ministry called Jobs for Life. They're preparing people who have had trouble finding a job or have some anxiety about finding a job. They're preparing them to interview well and to answer difficult questions and how to network effectively. It's a great ministry, but they're helping other people. Some of us are involved in Huntsville Inner City Learning Center. Others are deeply invested in His Way, helping men who struggle to fight addiction. Cindy Thompson and Amy Smith and many others of you work with Meals on Wheels. Some of us are involved with Hacienda of Hope. We'll take up a special contribution for them next week. That's our Ecuador mission. Right here at home, Tracy Pollard leads our mower ministry. We actually have a ministry where people go out and mow. They help folks do light yard work. Older folks who can't do it themselves, they help them do light yard work, keep their grass cut. They help people who can't help themselves. There's Prepare and Respond, our disaster recovery teams. And then there are the informal ways that so many of you help. Lisa and I experienced a beautiful example of what that kind of unity looks like just this past week with the passing of her mom. We had so many people show up with practical help in so many ways, little ways that might not seem all that big, but in real terms helped us find some rest from the stress of losing a loved one. Stuff like tending to our dogs when we were with her mom in her last hours, or the day of the funeral itself, like taking time off from work to come to the visitation or the service, providing food for the extended family, sending cards or text messages or kind words. You might not think stuff like that counts, but it does. When you visit somebody in the hospital, when you volunteer in our children's ministry, when you send a card, make a phone call, cook a meal, host a small group, teach a class, give a single mom a break by watching her kids, write a letter, greet a new face in the crowd on a Sunday morning, you're fulfilling your purpose for being here. You are helping. But the story answers another question. Not just why are we here, but why should we help? Joshua rooted the reason. This is really important, okay? Still with me? Joshua rooted the reason for helping others in what God had already done for the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh. Here's what he said: you guys have to do this. You have to help your brothers and sisters find rest because God has given you rest. The order of that is really important. What he didn't say was, if you want to have rest, you have to help them. He said, you've already been given it. Now, because of that, go help. He has given you rest, so you should help your brothers and sisters. Everything we do is a response to what God has already done. The more we realize how much God has done for us, the more motivated we are going to be to do for others. Here's the thing I think. I haven't formulated this really well, so it may come out wrong. I think when we base our unity solely on whether or not we agree, it's shallow and it's a vulnerable unity. But if our unity is based on what God has done for us first, and if it is fleshed out in how we serve one another, how we are there for one another, how we help one another, then that unity will be strong and robust even when we disagree. Think about that just a little bit. Let that roll around in your head. If our unity is only based on propositional agreement, it's going to be weak and vulnerable. But if that unity is based on what God has done for us, and if we express that unity by being there for each other in practical ways with real-time help, that unity will be strong and robust. I'm wondering if that's true. So I heard a great story about this a few years ago. There was this church that had been around for nearly 50 years, long enough to see its community explode with growth and flourish and then decline and then begin to grow and flourish again. Kind of like parts of Huntsville. I mean, you've seen that, right? You've been in communities that they're brand new and they grow and they're great, and then over time they begin to decline and then they begin to flourish again. Well, this church was a part of one of those communities and watched that happen through every phase. And as the community around it began its renaissance, young families moved in, bought the old houses, and fixed them up. The leadership of that church realized they had this really great opportunity to reach these young families with the good news about Jesus, but they'd have to overcome the inertia of doing things the way they'd always done them. And so they prayed. They just prayed. They prayed long and hard, and then they planned, and they came up with a new vision to reach that community. But the leaders were still really nervous because churches, bless our hearts, are fond of inertia. It's one of our favorite things. So they weren't sure how this new vision was going to be received. They called a meeting, they presented their plan, and there was silence until one man stood up and spoke, one of their oldest members, founding member of their congregation. Here's what he said. A lot of us raised our children in this community and in this church. It was a good place to grow up. It was a good church to grow up in. God, listen to what he said and the order in which he said it. God has blessed us in many ways. It is time for us to be a blessing. And so because God has blessed us, he said we can pray for this vision. He said we can pay for this vision, and we can participate in this vision. You know what that sounds like? That sounds exactly like what the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh told Joshua. Whatever you need us to do, we'll do it. Wherever you need us to go, we'll go. Only be strong and courageous. Why are we here? We are here to help. Whatever, wherever. I'll tell you what else that sounds like. That sounds a lot like the passage that Matt read for communion this morning, Philippians chapter 4, where Paul talks about what Jesus did for us. Paul told the Corinthians that Jesus made himself poor so that we might become rich. In that passage Matt read, he said that Jesus put our interests ahead of his own. So if that's what Jesus has done for us, then that's what the people who follow Jesus are called to do for others. Look, we have a legacy here at Twickenham of doing whatever needs to be done, wherever it needs doing, in order to help others find the rest that we have found. The more we focus on what he's done for us, the more motivated we are going to be to do for others. The story in Joshua points to the cross, and the cross points the way. And the way is that we put others first, we serve, we show our unity by being there and doing for and helping. That's how we do it. Let me ask you to stand. We're going to have a prayer about that right now, and then we'll finish up our service. Father, you have so blessed us. Last week we prayed for Farah, and this week she had her surgery, and so far the news is good. We praise you for that. We've prayed so many other prayers for so many other people, and you've answered us time and again. You don't always give us the answer we want, but you always answer, you always hear. But God, the greatest thing you've ever done for us was to make a way. You made a way for us to have a relationship with you. You made it possible for us to even survive this prayer. I mean, we're standing in front of your throne. We are in your throne room. We are praying to you, and we're going to live to tell about it because of Jesus. You made a way for us to be forgiven of the guilt of our sins and restored to a relationship with you. You have given us rest in your presence. Now, because of that, we are asking you to open our eyes to the needs of people around us, that we may see them and go in with help, to be there for people in loyalty and in unity and in love. God, help our unity be more than just agreement on a set of propositions. Help it be the unity that shows up when somebody is sick, when somebody is sad, when somebody is dying, when somebody has died. Help us be the kind of unity that shows up when people commit sin and make grievous mistakes and are trapped in the consequences of their own awful behavior. Help us be there for them in those moments, protecting, loving, forgiving, trying to bring healing in any way we can. God, for what you've done for us, thank you. And may it empower us to be one with one another and to do for everybody we see what you've done for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ.
Great to be back here in gloomy, dark, wet Huntsville, Alabama. Last week, it's just so great to be back. After last week, I worshiped online with you with the sun and the sand and the whales frolicking in the Sea of Cortez. It is great to be back. In all seriousness, Amy and I do thank you for affording us the opportunity to enjoy that time together. So from us, thank you very much for all that you've done for us. Also this morning, good news, Farah has gone home from the hospital this morning, and we're just going to keep praying, right? We're just going to keep praying. That's all we're going to do. Less importantly, these things as we close. The TCM ministry, our children's ministry, has a lock-in this Friday, March 2nd. That starts at 4. It's for 2nd through 5th grade. All the information's in the bulletin. Especially this morning, if you'd like to volunteer, please give Amy a call so that I don't have to come up here and stay all night on Friday. Please please do that. For all of those families, notice that. Also, children's ministry, you have a Love in Action next Saturday where families get together and we go out and visit and take cookies and do nice things for some of our older people and shut-ins and folks like that. It's a really good time together as family. For our senior members and our youth, don't forget, next Saturday is the feast, March the 3rd. It starts at 6. If you haven't signed up, folks, you can still do that. Just call the office and RSVP there. Also, this morning, we have been ramping up for several weeks now on our upcoming contribution for the Hacienda of Hope, and that is this coming Sunday. So this morning, as another reminder before we get to next Sunday, let's see a quick video about what's going on down there.
Antes, cuando estaba en otra escuela, a una señora que limpiaba, como mi mamá no podía comprar los uniformes y siempre veníamos con los mismos uniformes y después vino a hablar mi mamá acá si podía estar aquí y el Mr. Jerry dijo que sí.
Y dime de su vida ya que llegó aquí, ¿cómo ha cambiado su vida?
Que es más limpio y que tengo más cosas como el piso y toda la casa como tengo.
Dime un poco del piso, ¿por qué es diferente del piso?
Porque allá solo pusieron piedras, solo tienen piedras y tierra, nada más.
¿Y qué más? ¿Qué otros cambios?
Como los baños y antes teníamos que ir a lavar la ropa muy lejos y...
¿De dónde fueron a lavar la ropa?
Más lejos de mi casa.
Ok. ¿En una lavandería o dónde lavaron la ropa?
En un río.
¿Me puedes decir lavamos la ropa en un río?
Lavamos la ropa en un río.
Ok, good. ¿Y el baño? Dime un poco del baño.
Solo son con tablas y nada más.
Okay. ¿Hay otros cambios?
Que hacía mucho frío y nada más.
Dime un poco de cómo Dios te ha impactado.
Que me ha ayudado en todo, en mis estudios y que me ha ayudado en mi familia y que pude conocer a más familia que yo aún no conocía antes.
Okay. ¿Y usted espiritualmente cómo has cambiado aquí?
Ahorita estoy leyendo la Biblia que antes no, aún no leía.
Okay. ¿Qué más me dijiste? ¿Otra cosa?
Que antes no sabía quién era Dios y ahora ya sé quién es.
¿Hay algo más que te gustaría que gente sepa de este lugar?
Que es muy hermoso y tienen cosas muy hermosas y que pueden conocer a Cristo.
Ok, chévere. Si vas a decir a alguien sobre este lugar o tratar de convencerles venir acá, ¿qué dirías?
Que nos enseñan, que pueden enseñarnos cosas nuevas que no sabíamos y que pueden ayudar a otros niños a como que anden en la calle, a que no roben y no anden peleando.
We know from having Justin and Johnny here just a couple weeks ago, the great mission and vision that our team here and they are doing in Ecuador. And we have striven for a large number this year, $272,000. And you know what? I'm confident, and I'll tell you why, because Jody just said it. God has blessed us in many ways, and now it's time again for us to bless others. Amen? Hey, thanks for being here. Let's stand. We're going to close in prayer, and I hope you have a fantastic week this week. Thanks for being here.
Let's pray. Most kind Heavenly Father, great and awesome God, We hope and we pray that our worship this morning has been pleasing to you. We hope and pray that our hearts and our spirits are the hearts and spirits after your own heart and spirit, God. Father, we are mindful of the many blessings that you've given us, and hopefully this Father week, we hope that we will reach out to others, that we will serve others, that we might become closer to each other and closer to you, that we'll find that unity. Father, we're thankful for the many things you've given us. We know there are a lot of people in this world that have a lot less in their life. And Father, we just hope and pray that you help us to open up our hearts, open up our spirits to be more mindful, be more thoughtful about those that have been less fortunate physically than us and materially than us. And Father, we hope and pray that we can reach out to them, not just to help them in their lives, but to open up their spirit and see that you are the true, the one, the living God that changes people's hearts forever. And Father, in some way, some small way, help us to help them see you in those things. Not that we would be glorified, but that you would be lifted up and that you would be glorified. And Father, we hope and pray that each of us glorify you this week in our lives and everything that we do. We thank you for the many blessings, and for us in your Son's name we pray. And the Lord's church said,
Amen.